ketubah is a part of Jewish tradition where it's like a marriage contract where you, it's sort of like your vows, but it's written out and you sign it together. And Becky and Jeff's is a little bit less strict Orthodox traditional, but still in that spirit of joining together. And Becky drew this herself, and it's beautiful. And we're going to sign it now. So I'm going to read to you what it says, and then we'll sign. In Freehold, New Jersey, on Saturday, March 23rd, 2019, Rebecca Lee Temkin and Jeffrey Kyle Shippen have come together as bride and groom, surrounded by the warmth and love of family and friends, to enter into marriage and embark on their next phase of life as husband and wife. Today, we promise to love, respect, and treasure each other, and to walk through life as equal partners. May our love provide us with the freedom to be ourselves and the courage to follow our mutual and individual paths. May we grow together and support each other in all the years to come. Today, we joyfully enter into this union and solemnly accept the responsibilities this brings.
And the tissues are.
Here you go.
I can bring it back for now.
Okay.
You want
more?
So we're gonna sign, and then we're gonna have our best man and our maid of honor also sign, and our officiant Daniel sign, and then we'd love everyone in this room to put a gold thumbprint on our tree.
That's so
down on it, and then just anywhere up on where the leaves would be. Perfect.
All right, for me to use my left hand?
Yeah.
Thank you.
The left hand, yes, but your right finger.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Parents.
All right, parents.
Room spinning.
Oops.
And your left hand?
Friends.
Just wanted to be special. Just
oh my god, that is gorgeous. Wow. It's so beautiful.
This is my art project. Did you write these?
Wow.
Scripture project.
All in one.
Okay, you're so beautiful.
I remember going to the room in Formosa.
Dearest friends and family, welcome to the wedding of Rebecca Lee Temkin and Jeffrey Kyle Shippen. I'm Daniel, older brother of the beautiful bride, and on behalf of both of our families, I'd like to say how deeply happy we are to be sharing this special occasion together with you today. Jeff, Becky, you two first met in 2010 as college freshmen, And you stand here today after dating and sharing your lives together for over 8 years. In many ways, you already know a lot about what it means to commit to each other and build a life together as a family. And yet, in other ways, I know how excited both of you are to begin the next chapter of your journey as husband and wife, forming an even deeper bond as you join in marriage. Marriage is not merely a ceremony or a societal tradition we follow. It is a pact that we choose to make with the person we love deeply, someone we trust and want to share our life with. You too have that love and trust, and you are ready for the next step. Your wedding today is both an important statement of your commitment to one another and also a celebration and testament to the love that you clearly share. As part of today's ceremony, you ask for some of the most important people in your life to come forward and share their words of support, wisdom, and love. With that in mind, I'd like to invite our mothers, Margaret Temkin and Catherine Mulville Shippen, to come forward.
To share a piece of advice or wisdom that we had gained along the way. So I've spent the last few months sifting through memories from the many years that Larry and I have been together, recalling a multitude of experiences and special times that we've shared, as well as the innumerable lessons learned along the way. And it's actually given me a lot of pleasure. So the first thing I need to say is thank you, because it was an unexpected gift to me. After 43 years of marriage, I have a lot of little pieces of advice to pass along, like remembering to tell each other I love you and to do it often, or to tell your spouse something specific that you like about them, or to do something nice just for the fun of it. I don't know anyone who gets tired of being on the receiving end of a nice comment or a loving action, so don't ever underestimate the great addition that those types of things make to any day. But the two of you have been a couple for 8 years, and I've actually observed that you're well on your way to mastering these relationship 101 lessons. So let me turn to another topic that I know it took me a long time to appreciate. That topic is growth, both as individuals and as a couple. If you're lucky, your lives will not be static. You'll take up new hobbies, you'll make new friends, you'll be engaged in new experiences like traveling or having children or working at new jobs, and each of you will grow over the way. And I have three pieces of advice about that growth. First of all, for each other, allow that growth. By allow, I mean don't begrudge your spouse the time that it takes to be engaged in what interests them, even though it will sometimes be at the expense of your own personal time or your together time. And by allow, I also mean don't be afraid or jealous of how it might change your spouse. The second piece of advice about your spouse's growth is to enjoy and encourage it. Listen to what your partner has to say about their new experiences. And actively engage in conversations about what they've learned or how it affects them. Maybe even suggest that they take more time to engage more extensively in that interest. And then my last piece of advice is for the sake of your relationship and for your growth as a couple. Embrace the growth that you see in your spouse and make it your own, too. Become actively involved in an activity that's important to them, or choose new interests that you can undertake together. So of all the things I might have talked about, why would I choose growth as being something so important? Well, what I've observed is that the personal growth of your spouse will develop and reveal many facets in their character. It'll make them a more interesting person, and it will result in a spouse who interacts on more levels with more depth. And in turn, you'll find that your love for them is more nuanced, and you'll have a partner whom you admire in more ways and love more deeply. And when you engage in activities together, you allow for a similar transformation as a couple. You'll have fun together, face challenges together. You'll see your spouse in action. You'll see firsthand what drives them or frustrates them, what excites them, how they react to certain situations. And you're going to discover ways in which you can support each other, how your strengths and weaknesses can complement each other, and you'll be developing a team strategy along the way, and your bond will be that much stronger.
I'm honored to have been asked to speak today about values that are important for a good marriage. I feel that both Jeff and Becky have been blessed throughout their lives to be surrounded by many people in solid marriages, role models for what it takes to have a strong and lasting relationship. Many of them have seen good examples within their families and their family friends, many of you sitting with us here today. Since I too feel blessed to know so many people in exemplary marriages, I have used many of them as a resource and have been taking the time to ask what they would consider to be the most important value for a good marriage. Everyone I talk to seem to appreciate the opportunity to think back on their own relationships and on what was important to them. And I would like to share with you some of the wise and wonderful ideas that they have entrusted me with. Honesty and communication have been a common theme among people I talk to. My mother-in-law feels that the most important value for a good marriage is honesty. On the other hand, my friend Diane's advice is to hold your tongue. She suggests counting to 10 before saying something in anger or in order to win an argument. Be aware of what you say and be careful with the power of your words. As my father likes to say, you should never call your partner an idiot unless they are really acting one, like that. And you can ask my parents the story of the coffee maker. My friend Lisa suggests making sure to listen first instead of assuming that you already understand everything the other one is thinking and avoid just jumping in to try and save the day by solving the other person's problems. And my boss, Sarah, says you must always continue to communicate with each other, even with, and especially with, difficult subjects, before the issues grow too big to be able to talk about them at all. Having activities that you enjoy is very important for a good relationship. My friend Janet suggests that you have activities that you enjoy together. My sister Leslie would like you to enjoy each other's company and to work to keep that joy. On the other hand, my friend Barry suggests that you have your own hobbies. And Colleen suggests allowing your partner to continue to do the things that they really care about rather than just expecting to do everything together. And Bill very wisely suggests you should not expect to be able to change the other person, to mold them into exactly what you want them to be. So just love them and appreciate them the way they are. Your respect and commitment to each other is something that you should continue to remind yourselves of throughout your lives. Nancy and David suggest that you believe in your relationship and work to make sure your marriage will last a lifetime. Similarly, Jan says that you should not ever take your love for granted for each other. Always appreciate what your partner contributes, even the littlest things. She also feels that being able to laugh at yourself and laugh together is essential. And Mike and Natalie are confident that you can get through your good days and your bad days with kindness, patience, and wonder. As for my personal advice, I believe that you should have some shared adventures together. And by getting married today, surrounded by so many of your loving friends and family, you are starting down the road together in one of your most exciting adventures yet.
Thank And now we've come to a special part of Becky and Jeff's ceremony. I'd like to invite Jeff's grandpa, Dr. John McKim Melville, to come forward.
So I'm really honored as grandpa to give some information about these folks. And I'm also pleased to say that after 59 years of marriage, I have been called an idiot only once. So after getting engaged, among the many wedding questions Becky received from friends, in addition to, have you really known Jeff long enough? was what will you be doing with your name, with your last name? In fact, only moments after engagement, Jeff's sister, Becca, who photographed the big moment of their engagement, asked what Becky would do with her name. This question reveals at once both the progress toward gender equality that we have and still the vestiges of gender inequality within our society, and naturally, Becca's desire to remain the only Rebecca Shipman in the family. Immediately, Jeff and Becky, on getting asked this question, didn't have an answer. Instead, they engaged in a dialogue about what they would like to do. While each was very proud of and rather attracted to their given last names, they also wanted to share a last name that would represent their new family identity, their commitment to each other, and their partnership. They listed a dozen or so permutations of last names they could choose from: a one-person name change, a two-person hyphenation, taking each other's surnames as middle names, and, half-jokingly, creating a new name as a combination. They shared their hesitation with each other about changing their names. They shared concerns about losing a part of their individual identities. They were worried about statistics showing lower wages and less respect in the workplace after a name change. The sheer annoyance of all the paperwork and the process of switching over the formal documents. But a desire, a sincere and deep-felt desire to produce a name fairly. Through this process, the two came to realize that combining each other's name would represent the values that they share and those upon which they want to build their marriage: equality, partnership, and family ties. So with this, I invite Jeff and Becky to create their new family sign using building blocks from their given names to represent their union, to create a Mr. and Mrs. I won't say it yet.
Kilt the sign so the videographer can see you guys later.
Mr. and Mrs. Jeffrey.
Becky and Jeff have also asked that their siblings say something. So we're going to start with Becca, Jeff's sister, and then I'll follow her.
For those of you who don't know me, I'm the other Rebecca, Jeff's little sister. And first, as my grandpa said, I want to start off by saying just a small part of me is a little relieved that Becky is not taking Jeff's last name, because that would have meant there'd be two Rebecca Shippens in the world, and I can't have that. Not only would it be confusing to have two people in the same family responding to the exact same name, but I also currently have full claim to the username R. Shippen, and I'm not about to start using R. Shippen 1. But I'm not just relieved about the last name they chose. I also think it's really cool that they decided to merge their names. Some people might find it a little strange, but by taking half of one name and half of the other name, they're starting their marriage and their new identity as a family as truly equal partners. I'm so happy for the two of you. I've known Jeff for a long time. And Becky, you couldn't have picked a better person to spend the rest of your life with. Although we weren't always interested in the same things, and he was a few years older than me, he always made a point of including me, his little sister, his annoying little sister, when he and his friends did something fun. And when we were kids, if we were playing and he accidentally hit me with the ball or I fell down, he would immediately stop everything he was doing and come over to make sure I was okay. And more than that, he's always been one of the most supportive and encouraging people in my life. And as much as I love my brother, I would be lying if I said I didn't want a sister when I was growing up. Someone who could do art projects with me, and someone who I could talk to about more personal things, and who maybe wouldn't beat me at every single game we've ever played. Although I feel like Becky still would. She's a great match for Jeff. But in the past several years, I really do feel like I've gained a sister, and I couldn't have asked for a better one. Becky has been a wonderful addition to our family. We love who Jeff is when he's with her, not that he wasn't great already. And she has been such a positive force in my life, too. We do work on art projects together, and she really encourages me to spend more time on art than on other things I love. And I feel like I can talk to her about some personal things in my life. And she even volunteers to come wake me up in the morning by jumping on my bed, which, as many of you know, is not an easy task. So I already have many happy memories with Jeff and Becky, and I'm looking forward to making a lot more. Becky, I'd like to officially welcome you to our family, and congratulations to the Shipkins.
Becky.
So cute.
Becky, I know you're 28 years old.
27.
And I know you're thriving in your young adulthood as you finish your MD, but I somehow still and probably always will think of you as my baby sister. Since the days when you really were the baby, you've always been a really constantly beautiful presence in our family. You shine with warmth and you make us laugh, and you've always been you with many specific qualities that still endure. Yes, I tease you about your space cadet photos as a child, and you still manage these amazing, illuminating bonehead moments. Like when we were in Philadelphia, you said, "Wow, did you guys know Christopher Columbus and I were born in the same year?" Wait, shut up. And yes, the struggle that you faced in the Target toy aisle trying to make a decision about what you should buy, that actually still persists today in your life in major decisions. But as much as we harp and tease you about those sorts of things, Many of your other traits have been just as enduring. You've always had a lot of spunk, and you were by far the cutest of the three of us. That was something Andrea and I noticed you were able to exploit masterfully as a teenager. You got way more leniency from Dad than the two of us ever did. And you've always had an ability to genuinely crack me up, whether it's your funny faces and your manic giggles when you're riled up, and even your biting sass when you say, "Uppie," and "Got him." And we all know the Becky loopy laugh as you are crashing towards your bed tonight. You've also been particularly conscientious your whole life. You care for others and you empathize with them emotionally. Whether it's me or your sister Andrea, or whether it's total strangers that you encounter in your work. As much as I think of you as the baby, you've actually always been remarkably insightful and mature. You notice important small details about others, you notice the struggles they're going through, and you always put their concerns and well-being above your own immediate interests. This other-centeredness and generosity that you show is one of the things that has always made you Becky. You know I've always been proud of you, your work ethic, your achievement, your athletic ability, your immense creative talent. But as a young adult, you are blossoming in ways that make your sisters Ching and Andrea and me so immensely proud. Your efforts in City Year and what you've done with the Inspire Project to help young mothers who are battling with depression, these are nothing short of brilliant and deeply inspiring. You've been devoting major time tackling questions about altruism and intersections of healthcare and education and social opportunity. And all of your gifts are sort of coalescing into the total Becky package. Your intellect, your creativity, passion, and this other-centeredness, they're combining and making a deeply meaningful impact on others. You will always be my baby sister, but I could not be more enamored and thrilled with the young woman you're becoming. Jeff, it goes without saying that you have a very special bride here, and I know that you will love her and cherish her deeply, and I certainly expect you to. It's funny, my parents had spent time with you on a handful of occasions before Ching and I ever had the chance to meet you, and I would ask my dad, "So what's Becky's boyfriend like?" And he would reply, "How should I know? He never talks." Now, of course, to us brash and verbose Tempkins, that might be the case for a lot of people in my dad's mind. But when Ching and I finally did meet you, we instantly felt a warmth and connection, and we could sense already very early on that you and Becky were pretty serious. I've had the chance to get to know you for quite a long time in our family. Yes, Becky caught the bouquet toss at my wedding in 2014. And Jeff broke my own personal record of waiting 7 years to propose to my wife. I don't know what's wrong with us. We have pretty amazing gals. So. But I have had the chance to know you for a long time, and in that time, I've known you to be a true partner for my sister, providing steady, supportive, and constant love that she needs, especially as she navigates the up and downs of all of her stress and studying and Beckiness. I've also learned that while you'll often defer in conversation to the loudmouths in our family, you are always thinking deeply and thoughtfully, like Becky, with a heart that genuinely cares about others. Honestly, if you weren't a Michigan fan, you'd be basically perfect with It's been really, really amazing getting to know you and Becca, and I know that we really feel lucky to have you both as our siblings. As you take my sister's hand in marriage, I want you to promise me that you'll take good care of her and love her the same way you would want your sister's husband to take good care and love her. Becky and Jeff, I love you both so much, and I'm so deeply joyful to see you here today as bride and groom. Okay, now we come to a part that I, for one, am pretty excited about. These are your vows to one another, and you promise to deliver them with the warmth and whimsy of true Becky and Jeff style.
Who's going first? All right, yeah.
Three, two, one.
Jeff.
Becky.
I promise.
To be honest.
To be trusting.
To be patient.
To be kind.
To greet you every morning.
To kiss you every night.
To give you the best of myself.
To ask no more than you can give.
To respect you as an individual.
To respect you as an individual.
I will express my thoughts and feelings.
I will turn towards you, not away.
I will cherish you.
And love you.
And tell you I love you often.
I will support you in whatever you choose to do.
I will support you in whatever you choose to do. I choose you to be my wife.
I choose you to be my husband.
To be your partner.
Your fellow adventurer.
And your companion for life.
I accept you as you are today.
I will grow with you as we change over time.
I will stand by you through good times and bad.
I will be there with you through laughter and tears.
And if either one of us breaks these promises,
I promise to forgive and to move on with our lives together.
This ring box comes from Becky's grandmother, who you both know so well, actually living together with her for a year in her Milwaukee home. And the ring that you, Jeff, helped custom design for Becky features stones that were originally in the ring of her grandma. Like both of your grandparents and your parents, you two now stand ready to officially become husband and wife. And these rings, which you'll wear around your fingers, are not only symbolic of your love, they're a physical object you can feel and touch every day to remind you how lucky you are to share in the joy of love that you found together. Becky, will you please place Jeff's ring around his finger? Jeff, will you please place Becky's ring around her finger? Do you, Rebecca Lee Shipkin, take Jeff to be your lawfully wedded husband?
I do.
Do you, Jeffrey Kyle Shipkin, take Becky to be your lawfully wedded wife?
I do.
By the power vested in me, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Jeff, you may kiss the bride.
Thank you. of the evening. If you please turn your attention to the main entranceway, we have some very special and important people to introduce. Starting off with the parents of our bride, make some noise for Meg and Larry Temkin. Beautiful couple right there, beautiful couple. Next up, with an equally warm round of applause for the parents of our group, make some noise for Kathy and Chuck Shippen. Next up, we have your bridal party. Make some noise for our ladies, maid of honor Andrea Temkin, and bridesmaids Rebecca Shippen and Jim J. Beautiful trio, beautiful. And that makes the noise for our fellas, best man Taylor Knowles, and groomsmen Ari Isaacson and Nico Romies. Yeah, shake it, fellas, shake it. One more time, make some noise for your bridal party. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the moment you've all been waiting for. If you have not done so already, I'd like to ask everyone here to please rise. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me the greatest pride and pleasure to introduce to you, for the first time anywhere as husband and wife, ladies and gentlemen, the brand new Mr. and Mrs. Shipkin! As our bride and groom make their way into the dance floor, I need everyone to go to the edge of the dance floor, please. One more time, please give your bride and groom a huge round of applause. They look absolutely stunning here this evening. Folks, it was a few short hours ago that we witnessed their very first kiss, and now we witness their very first dance. A mashup made by Becky's brother. Make some noise for the brand new Mr. and Mrs. Shipkin. here on the dance floor and join your bride and groom for a Jewish tradition we call the Hora. Two big circles for our bride and groom. We'll start off to the right. Alright, now I need all the immediate family members in the middle, all the family members in the middle. Alright, everyone stand right there and clap those hands. Back to the right, everybody. You know that we're in sing along. Within the smaller circle in the middle, I just need Jeff and Becky in the center. Everyone stand there and clap those hands. Oh yeah. And we're gonna bring it to the middle. Everyone bring it to the middle! Everyone say woo! And then we're gonna do it one last time, one more big finish. Everyone say woo! So to start off the toast, I'm going to hand it to these kind of important people. You may know them. They're the Shipkins, so make some noise for these two once again.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for being here with us tonight. It's a pretty amazing feeling to have people from almost all stages of our lives here in one room. We're so excited and grateful that all of you are able to be here and share this special day with us. We hope that tonight you'll eat, dance, and enjoy yourselves. We want to put some special mentions in about a few things tonight. At your seats, you've probably seen a little bingo and crossword puzzle. That's just there because we love a couple games. There's also a guest sign-in tree that we're planning to hang as our first piece of art when we move into a house. We hope that you'll add your finger or thumbprint to help fill in the leaves. And this is sitting out in the entryway. So whenever you get a chance tonight, go out, add your thumbprint. It'll mean a lot to us. We also have a photo booth in here, so take lots of goofy pictures of yourselves for us. And then last but not least, we have a memento table where you can check out some of the special memories that we've put together from the last 8 years and all our times that we spent together.
We also have a very special table with pictures of our parents and our grandparents and even some of our great-grandparents from their wedding days. And we would not be the people we are today or be here at all today without these individuals. We are so glad to have Jeff's grandpa Nana here tonight. And in appreciation of the many other grandparents who couldn't be here with us tonight, we have placed my bridal bouquet on the table with their pictures. Above and beyond that small gesture, we want to say an especially big thank you to our parents who raised us, supported us, loved us, and helped us with all of the details for tonight. From the wooden centerpiece stands that you see on some of your tables that my dad helped us put together, to the incalculable hours of planning that my mom did, to 10 pounds of caramels that Jeff's mom made and are in your little favor boxes tonight, and to many, many conversations with Jeff's dad, who has very helpfully played devil's advocate, thoughtfully and considerately making us help make us make big decisions together, including how to change our names. We couldn't ask for better parents or better role models, and we love you so much. Last but not least, in fact, the reason that I may or may not have wanted this venue was the Venetian Hour, so make sure you enjoy all of the desserts. Thank you. We love you. Cheers. And cheers.
One more time, a big round of applause for our beautiful couple right here. So now I'm gonna hand the microphone over to four people. You'll notice your champagne glass on your table. Make sure to just little sips each time, not the whole entire thing on the first one. First off, I'm gonna hand it to the father of our bride. Make some noise for Larry. Where's Larry? There you are. Hi.
By the way, the Venetian hour is going to be an hour and a half tonight, so I'll talk about that. So welcome, everybody. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Larry, Becky's dad, and I can't tell you how thrilled I am that this day has finally arrived. Before beginning, I want to acknowledge those who couldn't be here tonight because of their schedules for some, or health for others, or because, sadly, they have passed away. I'm especially sorry that my mom isn't with us here tonight, because I know how much she looked forward to this day. Still, Meg and I are so pleased that all of you are with us on this really joyous occasion. This is my third, and I hope final, toast at my child's wedding, and also the hardest. This isn't because my baby girl is all grown up and married the man of her dreams. It is for another reason, which I can convey with a brief story. Some years back, we found an old video of a singing program from Becky's preschool when she was 3. While the rest of the class was gaily belting out the songs, Becky was off to the side, head down, with her arms desperately wrapped around a pole, roughly like this, hanging onto it for dear life. One of the teachers gently tried to pry Becky's arms off of the pole while cajoling her to join the others, but Becky was having none of it. As the concert went on, Becky slowly slipped further and further behind the pole until she eventually totally disappeared from sight. That was my Becky then, and in some ways, it's my Becky today. Unlike her dad and siblings, Becky has never wanted to be the center of attention. Accordingly, Becky gave me strict orders to keep it short and to avoid my favorite Proud Papa stories. So you can see why this speech is so hard for me. Because I have to choose between respecting Becky's wishes and following Polonius's advice. To thine own self be true. Well, I don't know how to break this to you, Becky, but today, you and Jeff are the center of attention, so suck it up. So what can I tell you about Becky? If you know Becky, you know that despite her size, she's a gifted athlete. First dance class she ever took, she was so superior to the others that her teachers begged us to let her join their elite dance troupe, which competed throughout the region. Fortunately for us, Becky wasn't interested. Similarly, after her very first day of club volleyball practice, her coach came up to me and said, "I don't know what to say, Mr. Tepkin. I have nothing to teach her about digging a spike." If you don't know volleyball, I'm sorry, but if you do, you know what that means. Becky went on to star on many club teams, to win beach volleyball tournaments at all levels, including the pro level, and to be the school's first volleyball player, male or female, to play varsity from the first game of freshman year. Excuse me. By the time she graduated, Becky had held many school records and was the most decorated female volleyball player in school history. In college, Becky played ultimate frisbee, and though she will never be the best ultimate player in her family, she was a two-year captain on a highly competitive club team. Not exactly a dumb jock, I used to tease Becky that she had a massive computer for her brain. Mainly, I did this to boost her confidence, since she would never quite realize just how smart she was. But it was true. Over the years, Becky has had many interests, including biology, physics, history, theater, anatomy, writing, art, and dancing. She loves to bake, and some of you know that. She especially loves cupcakes. Not a typical pre-med student, Becky majored in anthropology, and she minored in writing. Becky also loves traveling, which is lucky since our family traveled a lot. Once, while she was still in middle school, Becky overheard Meg and me deciding to not move our children again, since they'd already lived in Houston, Boston, Oxford, and East Brunswick. Becky firmly informed us that she liked living in different places, and then promptly plotted out the ideal destination, Australia, and the ideal timetable, second semester, sophomore year, when Andrea would be at college and after volleyball season. As one of her teachers noted when she was only 5, Becky is small but mighty. So naturally, I had to find a way to make it happen. Becky was also a driving force behind a globe-trotting trip to India, Thailand, Cambodia, Nepal, and Jordan. And she also traveled alone to England and, much more daringly, to Kenya. Still, Becky's strongest attribute, by far, is her character. She is sensitive, caring, and loving. Moreover, she has great integrity and a huge heart and a deep desire to help others. In high school, she volunteered to help people with special needs. In college, she volunteered for the African Medical and Research Foundation, which took her to clinics in poor African villages into Kibera, Africa's largest slum. Following college, Becky worked for City Year as a tutor for at-risk students. She saw firsthand youth who were pregnant, came from abusive homes, or had parents who were addicts, alcoholics, unemployed, absent, gang members, or in jail. The work was tough, but she loved it. And when City Year begged her to remain, she agonized greatly before continuing on to medical school. In medical school, Becky co-created, as you heard earlier, a program called Inspire, using art therapy to help women cope with perinatal mood disorders. It was a smashing success, and Inspire may soon be in hospitals and women's clinics throughout New Jersey. Meanwhile, keen to improve healthcare delivery to underserved populations, Becky is currently pursuing a master's degree in public health at Harvard, where in addition to courses, she is doing a project on gun violence. So you can see why I couldn't be more proud of my sweet Becky. Indeed, there has not been a single moment in her entire life when Becky did or said something that made me cringe. She really is a remarkable woman. Next, let me talk about Jeff. As I've known Jeff less long, my remarks will be shorter, but still heartfelt. To start, Jeff is a lot like Becky. He's a gifted athlete, as is apparent to anyone who has ever seen his calves. He excelled at numerous sports growing up, and also in high school, before focusing on ultimate frisbee, or just ultimate, as they call it, in college and beyond. This past year, Jeff fulfilled a bucket list dream when one of his three ultimate teams made it to nationals. Jeff is also, yes, the team is here. All right, it's here for the team. Jeff is also incredibly smart, but unless you're playing a game of strategy with him, in which case, good luck, you might not notice, since he, unlike a few other people in the family, isn't constantly showing everyone just how smart he is. I know that Becky is awed by Jeff's intelligence, which says a lot. Jeff also has a great sense of humor, which is often understated, yet devastatingly sarcastic. But most importantly, Jeff is a man of impeccable character. He's honest, loyal, and faithful. A man I would and indeed am trusting with something more valuable than my life. Jeff is not the most communicative person I know, nor the most romantic, though I must say that his proposal to Becky was one for the ages. But Jeff reflects the good Midwestern values of his wonderful family, and I'm totally thrilled about that. In many ways, Jeff reminds me of the two people I admire most, my dad, a salt of the earth chemical engineer, and my incredible wife. Believe me, I don't make such comparisons lightly, but I see them as apt. Jeff has been there with Becky and for Becky since they first began dating their freshman year. Jeff has moved with Becky, supporting her career and life choices from St. Louis to Milwaukee to New Jersey to Boston and soon back to New Jersey. And he has never once, so far as I know, begrudged Becky for the ways that such moves might be diverting his goals or plans. Along the way, Jeff has lived in turn with my mom, Becky's sister Andrea, and even Megan. I am well aware that our family can be overwhelming. But Jeff has put up with all of us with a deep reservoir of calm and goodwill that he carries with him wherever he goes. Becky has always put Jeff up on a pedestal. Jeff, in turn, has served as Becky's rock, as Meg has served as mine. There isn't much more than one could hope for in a maid-fluence child. Becky and Jeff have been together for 8 years now, and we welcomed him to our family long ago. So it gives me enormous pleasure on their wedding day to officially welcome him, his wonderful parents and sister, Chuck, Kathy, and Becca, his grandparents, and all the rest of his family into our family. May each of you in your own ways, Becky and Jeff, may you have many, many years together filled with good health. May each of you in your own ways continue to help make the world a better place. And may you enjoy all the blessings that life can bestow on a couple that truly loves and respects each other. To Becky and Jeff.
Well done, Larry. Well done, Larry. Next up, we have the father of our groom. Makes a noise for Chuck. He's running over here. He's running.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Chuck Shipman. I am the father of the groom, and now I can say I am the father-in-law of the lovely bride.
Gives me great pleasure to do that.
The first thing that I would like to do tonight is I would like to have all of us thank our wonderful hosts for tonight, for today, for Meg and Larry Temkin and the entire Temkin family. So please join me. They are absolutely splendid hosts. They're warm, they're gracious, they're welcoming, brimming with good humor. From my view, and from Kathy's, it's impossible to imagine a better family for Jeff to be marrying into. In fact, I have to say, the Temkins are so wonderful as both hosts and new family members that, and as a native Chicagoan, I can even overlook what is clearly their one hopeless flaw, this strange and unfortunate tendency to root for those teams that are from Wisconsin somewhere. There's no explaining fandom, I guess. Anyway, I also wanted to do something else right now, which is to pass along some thoughts from someone who wasn't able to join us today, Jeff's grandma. Although she's very sad that she can't be here today, she wrote to them. And what she wrote is this: I have your invitation, which shows your great love for each other, and that makes me so happy. All my good wishes are with you today, especially having witnessed the great love you have for each other. Best of luck and much love to both of you. Enjoy a wonderful future together. Okay, what I would like to do now is somewhat similar to what Larry was just doing and spend a little bit of time telling you about Jeff and Becky. Becky's family and friends know her well, but they know Jeff less well, and vice versa. So let me start with Jeff. There's been a theme running through some of the comments that you might have noticed. And I'll put it this way. Jeff is a man of few words. During his teenage years in particular, that would be considered an understatement. So, Temkins, you've seen the less reserved version of Jeff. So, really, though, there's a standard view of boys, which is that once boys hit their teenage years, they withdraw. So boys, once they hit adolescence, go into their rooms, put on headphones, and come out 4 years later. And that sounds about right, actually. And if that wasn't your experience, you didn't have a standard teenage boy, I think. I could tell lots of stories about that, but I won't for reasons of time. But since Larry took liberties with some of his time, I think maybe I will tell one of those stories after all. It was back in high school, and Jeff's friend Hannah was having a party. So Jeff asked me, would I drive him over to Hannah's house for the party? I said, sure, of course. So we drove over to Hannah's house, and I dropped him off. And at the end of the night, he called me up and said, can you come pick me up? So I drove back over to Hannah's house, and Jeff got into the car. And so I asked him how the party was, and Jeff said,
And I think he was waiting for like a hole to open up in the earth to swallow the car in the meantime. Eventually he said, fine. And so I was encouraged, because now we were having a good conversation. And so I said, you know, we're still sitting in front of Hannah's house. And so I said to him, I said, so who was there? And the seconds ticked past, and time kept going. And eventually he said, me. And I said, well, good, I knew that part, because I've just picked you up. Was anyone else there? The stars went across the sky, the cars drove by, we sat there. And eventually, he said, and remember, we're at Hannah's house now. Hannah? So anyway, as I said, few words. But I want to do something, which is I want to contextualize that a little bit. And I want to give some perspective on it. And I don't want to overstate this tendency, as it's always been balanced by what I think is a truly admirable mixture of confidence and also rise into the moment. And that's whether it's been in music or sports, academics, or relationships. Just a couple of very quick examples. One of them is when we had the fortune to spend half a year in Ireland on sabbatical when Jeff was, I think, 10, probably. Does that sound right? When Jeff was 10 or 11 years old. We were a little bit worried about how he would be when we got there. We were much less worried about Becca, who we would have characterized as very strong-willed at that time. But we were a little concerned about how Jeff would do it. Well, within the first afternoon that we were there, Jeff had picked up a wiffle ball and bat he had brought with us, gone out to the park at the end of the street, gathered together all of the kids, and taught them how to play baseball. And he had organized a baseball game. And we sat there and we marveled at that. And that's how he treated the rest of the trip. Jumping into new sports and meeting new friends. And it's more than that. It's how he decided right after we moved to Ann Arbor to throw his hat in the ring to become the captain of the school soccer team, where he had to make a speech and convince people that this new kid should be the one that should be the captain, and he chose him. And similar things could be said for becoming the captain of his ultimate team in college, and rising to the challenge. I'll point out one other thing that goes along with this, which is that he's always had a great set of friends, and I think there's few things better you can say about a person than that they have a truly wonderful set of friends, and I'm delighted that so many of them are here today to share this moment with me. So, that's some context, I think, that's really necessary to understand and to know Jeff. But it's true that he has always been on the quiet side. So Kathy and I especially began to take notice during college when we started hearing more and more about this girl he had met, this lovely girl from New Jersey. As a side note, I will add that we met Becky very early on. I think it was the first or second month of college. So parents aren't always right about these things. Although parents, really, we are. But we saw the two of them together, and both of us, both Catherine and I, thought, I bet those two are going to be going out pretty soon. And that turned out to be the case. Well, over the next few years, we started hearing more and more about her, what she was like, what sorts of things they did together, how she was becoming an essential part of his life. We got to meet her more regularly, which was lovely, either in St. Louis or the times he would bring her home over break. And we got to see this relationship evolve. We got to see how comfortable they were together, how important they were together, how they fit together. And it was a lovely thing to see. Many, or maybe even most of you have heard about Jeff's proposal to Becky. And if you haven't, you should hear about it from somebody. What I want to say is, it was both families were gathered together for Jeff's birthday. They produced this incredibly elaborate dessert that revealed a ring. It was really amazing. But for me, the best part, and it's the part that often gets left out in retelling, the part that will always stick with me, was what Jeff said when he was proposing to Becky. Now this is in front of an audience of his family and Becky's family. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful. It was thoughtful and honest. It was generous. It was sincere.
and that's who he is. It was also, and I will take slight issue, it was wonderfully romantic, and that's also who Jeff is. That's something that I've seen actually for a long time. And it showed, to me, it showed that for him, that nothing else matters in the whole wide world when you're in love with a Jersey girl. And I, since we're in Freehold, I simply had to do that. I couldn't pass it up. And for anyone who didn't get that, I'll just explain it later. And Becky, sweet Becky. From the moment you first came to our house, you seemed like part of the family, so I'm delighted that it is now official. Those of you who don't know her well can immediately see that she is this smart, beautiful, and entirely captivating young woman. She's also so much more. She's a fantastic and creative artist. She's become a big sister to our daughter, Becca. She's a talented baker, a cupcake baker. She's an exceptional athlete, as Larry was talking about. Volleyball, beach volleyball, and like Jeff, captain of her college ultimate team. She's an exciting and excitable game player, a fun and sometimes fierce card player. But you know what? Those are the things she does. Who she is this kind, generous, fun, warm, and loving person. Together, you see Jeff and Becky bring out the best in each other. You see how they support each other, how they nudge each other, how they love each other. Individually, each is truly a good person. Together, they make a wonderful, remarkable couple. Becky, welcome to our family. Tempkins, thank you for welcoming Jeff into yours. Jeff and Becky, may you both continue to be the loving, thoughtful, fair-minded, fun, and supportive people you are today. And may you continue to bring out the best in each other. Cheers.
Together for the very proud fathers of our bride and groom, Larry and Chuck. Now comes for the second most important man. We have our best man, Taylor. Make some noise for Taylor.
Hi everyone, I'm Taylor Knowles, Jeff's college roommate, and I'll try to make this short. So, I've had the great pleasure of knowing Jeffrey since the first week of engineering school at WashU. And it has been wonderful seeing him grow into the amazing man he is, especially compared to the first year when he was, while still amazing, a little bit more aloof. For example, despite Becky sending many signals of her interest for 4 months, Jeff appeared oblivious to her advances. And really oblivious. Standing here 8 years later, seeing what a happy couple you are, one can only assume that you've gotten a lot better at picking up on her signals. Even though it's hard for anyone who knows them to separate their memories of Jeff and Becky together, I have many great memories of the time I spent just with Jeff. The first sign I had a true friend in Jeff was spending late nights together on problem sets for engineering math, which is possibly the hardest class any freshman could take. So forged in the fires of that mathematical furnace, our friendship grew strong. Not only did that tell me what an intelligent person Jeff is, but also how dedicated he is by helping everyone around him become their best self. So in other words, thank you for helping me pass my courses. Of course, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the one thing that brought Jeff, Becky, myself, and many others here tonight together, Ultimate Frisbee. As much as we enjoyed playing the sport, the times that we spent tossing the disc together were even more valuable for the quality time that we're able to spend. And it's what I believe really helped our friendship blossom. I always thought of Jeff as a leader on the field, and I looked to him as an example. The long weekends on faraway trips to cities for tournaments or for fun didn't hurt either. For example, our road trip to Galveston spring break of freshman year. And even though we didn't do any one standout thing, probably, I'll never forget the time we spent playing games and being generally ridiculous. I'm so glad Ultimate continues to be a part of your life, and I hope that it does for a very long time. Jeff, who made the summer internship before our senior year much brighter time, the company needs a St. Louis screw and bolt to break large steel bolts and surreptitiously play Knights and Dragons on our rigs, or on our phones. you may have been extremely bored and only really wanted to stack the bolts into tiny little towers and throw papers into buckets across the room, which you're extremely good at, by the way. You helped me get my first job, and I'm very grateful for that. Throughout the time that I've spent with Jeff, from Ultimate to the late night chapter meeting Star Fraternity, to hanging out in Mari's dorm room for hours on end, I've seen the best qualities of Jeff, such as patience, reliability, tolerance, wisdom, and always being down for a whimsy. And extremely sarcastic, of course. You enriched my life by being a friend who could relate to all those shared experiences and help me through them. And the same qualities that make you a good friend, as I share college life with you, are the qualities that are going to make you a great husband, as you share the rest of your life with Becky. Since Becky was also a part of our lives from the start at WashU, it's been equally awesome seeing the two of them grow into the picture-perfect couple that you are. I'm so glad that Jeff has found a wife that is as caring, fun-loving, determined to make a difference, and creative as Becky. Becky, I've seen you dress up many times, whether for our annual Frisbee Party Classy Contra or the semi-annual dance party Wine and Cheese. You've always loved playing dress-up with a passion, and I can say for a fact that today, your radiance and joy are clothing you with an even more beautiful outfit, and that's the one of love. So, Jeff, just try not to wrinkle your tux. Becky, Jeff, wish you nothing but the best. Love you both so much. Cheers to the beautiful couple.
And last but not least, make some noise for your maid of honor, Andrea.
Thoughtful and brilliant, and somehow has not adopted to be right that the rest of us have been so stubbornly hold on to. There used to be a joke among mine and Dan's friends that Becky is the best of the Tumpkins. But it's not really a joke. She really is the best.
That wasn't a joke.
A joke. Which is why, when Jeff and Becky first started dating, I had my doubts. As far as I was concerned, Rebecca was perfection incarnate, and whoever dated her should really be worshiping the ground that she walked on. And Jeff seemed very nice, but I wasn't really seeing enough worshiping as far as I was concerned. In Jeff's defense, I met him when he was 18, and he was doing what every college freshman should be doing, dating, but also like going to class, and playing sports, and hanging out with friends. But his big sister, I wasn't really sure why he wasn't spending the vast majority of his time doting on Becky. But then Becky decided to move to Milwaukee after college for city year, and Jeff moved with her. And I thought, okay, Jeff, I see you stepping up your game. Let's see how this goes. Then, just 1 year later, Becky chose to attend medical school in New Jersey, and Jeff came with her. Again, I was impressed. And when the three of us moved in together, I really started to see firsthand all the ways in which Jeff was a great fit for my sister. Rebecca holds herself to this ridiculous standard and can end up in this whirlwind of emotions when stressed or just hungry. And Jeff never really seemed rattled or put off by it. He was patient, stable, and there for her. There was one day when Rebecca was in the middle of studying for boards and, convinced she was going to fail, ended up in a puddle of tears and had partitioned herself in her room. Jeff came home from work and asked me, "So, how is she?" And I said, "Oh, you know, she's Becky." And Jeff kind of knowingly half smiled and nodded, and quietly walked off the room to be with her. Now, my entire life, I've had this grandiose notion that nobody in the world knew Rebecca the way I did, or could possibly provide her comfort the way I could. But I swear, in that moment, I felt like I had this partner, you know, my little sister. And that maybe it was possible that Becky would be okay without me, because Jeff would be there for her. The last thing I'll add is that even though I was a big sister, I was a little skeptical about the relationship at first. Rebecca has never had doubts. This is a girl who would literally cry in Toys R Us because she couldn't pick the doll she wanted, who will shoot down 20 dinner options because she can't decide, and who has agonized over every major life decision she has ever made. But I have never once heard her voice a decision about being with Jeff. From the get-go, she knew you were special. And even when you've had ups and downs, she never wondered if you were the right person for her. So Jeff, thank you for being such a wonderful partner to my best friend. And Becky, thank you for being the best sister I could have ever hoped for. I'm so excited to meet you too. Love you both. Cheers.
Once again, a big round of applause for Larry, Chuck, Andrea, and Taylor. Folks, dinner is going to be served in just a little bit, so feel free to sit back, relax, check out the photo booth, and we'll see you back on the dance floor very shortly.
We have a beautiful cake. Wow. So Becky is almost a doctor. So we have the first incision. But I made it up. Here comes the first incision. All right, excellent. And one just a little bit over. Second incision. Very nice. Oh, look at you. And now comes the fun part. We're going to do the cake feeding. Bobby's gonna grab that. Just a big shout out to the wonderful staff here at the South Gate Manor. They're doing an excellent job so far. Excellent food. So traditionally, the bride feeds the groom first. Folks, do you think Becky is gonna be nice about this? I don't know. Let's see. Very ladylike. Give her a big round of applause. Jeff, any married man will warn you about this next move. Folks, do you think Jeff will be as nice? I'm hearing mixed reviews. Let's see. The kick is up. And it's good. Give him a big round of applause. To a great song from Guns N' Roses. This is entitled Sweet Child of Mine. Big round of applause to the very proud father of our bride. One time, a huge round of applause for the very proud father of our bride. Congratulations, Larry. Well, there's only one way I know how to follow that. So Jeff, please escort your beautiful mother, Kathy, to the dance floor. They are dancing to an equally beautiful song. This is entitled 93 Million Miles by Jason Mraz. Get ready, see it ladies and gentlemen. At this time, I'd like to invite everyone to the dance floor, all those romantic couples, to join Jeff and Kathy. A big round of applause to the very proud mother